Troy, New York. This is UniHIG, the Upstate New York Healthcare Innovation Group. I'm Alex Fair, and I'd like to introduce you to Dr. Jacob Ryder from the Alliance for Better Health.
In the late 90s, I was blogging about health information technology and the absence of usability. I was a family doctor working for Capital Care Medical Group, where Craig is now the chief operating officer. And I was about 6 months after I wrote this blog post about how the usability of the product that we were using was suboptimal. Our chief medical officer called me into his office. He said, "Hey, you know, the president of the company that's our electronic health records vendor called us up and said, you wrote a blog post that cost them sales. So they'd like you to take that down." And I said, last I checked, it was a free country. We can blog, and of course, you know, still, no, this was, by then it was 2003 or so. Nobody really knew what a blog was, or a blog post. And so I said, thanks anyway, I'll leave it up. About 2 weeks later, the guy called me. The president of a roughly $200 million company called me up, and he said, "Hey, you know, this thing really sucks. It's really a problem." And we talked for half an hour, and I'll make the story short. 6 weeks later, I was a consultant for the company. And 2 years later, I was their chief medical officer. And, you know, it cascaded from there. We merged with a larger company. I became a senior leader at the larger company. The larger company, some of you may be familiar with, is Allscripts. So it's a large health IT company. So I was the CMIO, the Chief Medical Information Officer for Allscripts. And I did that from about 2007 through 2006 through about 2010. In my role working for Allscripts, which at that point was one of the largest health IT companies in the country, it's number three if you look at the number of physicians using the product. Epic is number one. Cerner is number two, Allscripts is number three. I became a member of an organization, our industry trade group, called the Electronic Health Records Association, where I interacted with the Department of Health and Human Services, and specifically the Office of the National Coordinator for Health IT, or otherwise known as ONC, or ONC. So this is the agency that regulates health information technology. So I started interacting with these folks at this federal agency, and again, I won't belabor the point too much. Not dissimilar to my interaction with this company years before, I pointed out some of the challenges that they were having in the market with which they were perhaps unaware. But I did it in a way that wasn't like a chipmunk biting at somebody's ankles. I did it in a constructive way to say, "Hey, you know, turns out that when health IT companies are trying to interpret this paragraph of this federal regulation that you guys have put out, they don't understand what the fuck you were talking about." So, I forgot to ignore the camera. you might express this in a different way. And so what that did was that caused me to get hired by them instead of the industry. So I went from primary care. Earlier in my career, I'd worked for Albany Medical Center, where I ran IT implementation from a clinical perspective. So that was too long ago, and I was the dean of biomedical informatics back when biomedical informatics didn't exist. So, you know, small pond, small person. Starting the institution on a path, I was reminded today, I created the Albany Med internet site back in the day. So amc.edu was my responsibility, believe it or not, umpteen years ago. And I ran it for about 6 months until I handed it off to the IT team. Because the IT team, they didn't know about this new thing called the internet. Right? They were running their PDP-11s and like focused on group-wise as this new innovation for our institution. So So I got hired by the government. I became the deputy of the Office of the National Coordinator. And between political appointees, I was actually the leader of that organization. About $200 million budget, about 300 staff. And mostly what we did was we created the regulations that define interoperability specifications for how electronic health records talk to each other. We added some things, remember my first blog post, that required the health IT companies to do things in the domain of usability, user experience. So this was actually the first regulation, the first federal regulation that imposed usability requirements on software. FDA has done it in the domain of devices, and I'm sure you've experienced that process. But it's never been done in software until our stuff. So I worked really closely with the folks at FDA to understand how they did it, and then we put it in our regulations. In 2014, my wife became the dean of Albany Law School, and she summoned me home because someone needed to walk the dog, and it wasn't going to be her. So I quit my job there and started working in the startup community. I'd done a little stint between Allscripts and the government. Turns out it takes about 9 months to get hired by the government. I don't know if anybody's had a federal job, but you know, everybody handshakes and agrees, and you go, sure, great idea. HR will be contacting you soon. No kidding. From our conversation until I was hired, it was roughly 9 months.
Same with that.
So I worked with, during that phase, I worked with a bunch of little startups, and I worked with some equity investors in Connecticut, and learned about the investment community, and got really interested in the investment community, and how it is that you can understand or predict, to Sean's comments earlier in the day, you know, which is going to be that one of seven that's actually going to be successful, and how investors do that. And I became a bit of an advisor to a handful of startup companies. I co-founded a couple of companies in that space. Some of them are now doing well, and some of them are dead. But learned a little bit about that. And then when I left the government, I did the same thing. So I joined an organization called Coastal Ventures. If anybody's heard of them, they're a VC firm in Palo Alto. And was their physician in residence, and was helping a number of their portfolio companies. One, a precision medicine company that was doing great work on data science, and a couple of other startups. I had a great time. It was a really positive experience, but found that I was missing being part of a team working on a project. And so doing the startup advising thing and doing consulting for the last couple of years, from about 2014 when I left the government until about 4 months ago, it was a great experience. And if anybody has done this, it's extraordinarily lucrative to be a consultant, especially for large companies. So I did some consulting for big companies like my former employer, Allscripts, and other large health IT companies. They would pay way too much money. And then we do work with startup companies. So the consulting activity that I did was run with a guy named Brian Sivak. If anybody's heard of Brian, he's the former chief technology officer for the Department of Health and Human Services. So Brian and I worked together at HHS, and we created this consulting gig. And we established relationships with about 15 startup companies, invested in about five of them. I still have relationships with those companies, and when I started my current activity, I had to list all of my activities in my agreement, so I counted them up, and it was 15, which is a little more than my wife would approve of, since my attention deficit disorder gets to this sometimes, but with our shared success. So, you know, the real reason I'm here today, and aside from wanting to support startups and really interested in what folks are doing around innovation, you know, I think about my career. It's always been about helping the little folks, right? Whether it's people who are Medicaid beneficiaries and therefore poor people, Or it's startup companies who are the innovators, who are thinking about how to disrupt the incumbents. Even when I was at Allscripts, I created a disruptive product. It was meant, and I used the Christensen-esque definition, right? So raise your hand if you read Clay Christensen. Okay, two of you. So for the rest of you, great. So Clay Christensen, who's a professor at Harvard Business School, coined the term disruptive innovation. And so we hear disruption a lot, but it's actually a subset of people who say disruptive or say I want to disrupt who actually have read his work. And so it's important to understand that what he was talking about when he talked about disruption was to contrast disruptive innovation from sustaining innovation. So sustaining innovation is an incumbent business, an organization that's doing well, say, IBM or Xerox, adding capabilities to the products that they currently offer. So, I point to Craig because I know he's implemented lots of these products. So Allscripts is a company, Cerner's a company, Epic is a company, and these companies come out with sustaining innovations that iterate upon the infrastructure that they built. They sell to legacy customers, right? They sell to Samsung, to Apple, right? An incumbent company sells to an Albany Medical Center, a St. Peter's, an Ellis. A disruptive company creates a solution that is attractive to the non-consumer, right? So Christensen talks about the Canon personal copier as an example of a disruptive product, right? So Canon, back in the early 1980s, had 1% of the copier market. And another company, name the company, Xerox, had 97% of the market, right? And when you went to Xerox your document, you went down the hall and there was this thing the size of Kansas, and it cost $100,000, and you'd put your thing and it could collate and it could staple, and collation and stapling and two-sided copying, these were all sustaining innovations, right? They made the product better and allowed them to charge $105,000 next year instead of $100,000 last year. Then Canon goes, well shit, let's make a personal copy. And it was for the person who wanted a copier on their desk. They didn't want to go down to the second floor to use their copier. And so it was the non-consumer, someone who wasn't buying a copier, because Marge wasn't buying $100,000 Xerox. Marge wanted a copier that was on her desk so she didn't have to walk to the second floor. And it would only do 25 pages, right? Remember these things? 25 pages and it would go, it would take too long, but it was a disruptive innovation because then it iterated and it got a little bit faster and it held more pages. And then it got a little bit faster and it held more pages. And then guess what? So the slope of innovation, of a sustaining innovation, goes like this. And a disruptive innovation goes like this, and at some point it crosses that line. And the disruptive innovation is better than the sustaining innovation. And guess who owns the copier market today? Canon. Sharp a little bit too, apparently. So if we look at sustaining innovations, a disruptive product's never gonna compete with the same market. And so as I look at startup companies and I think about, who's going to do really well, I look at edges of the market that are aiming for, or that are ripe opportunities for the disruptive innovators. Because competing with IBM, ain't going to happen, right? Competing with Cerner, competing with Epic, competing with Allscripts. So I've had a couple conversations today, including this afternoon when Craig was present, where we talked about care management, care coordination. That is the entry point. Mark my words, about 5 years ago I gave a talk to a bunch of investors in New York City, and they said, so what's the white space? And at that point I was, an important person from Washington. They were like, where's the white space? And I said, analytics. And they were like, okay. And everybody invested $1 billion in analytics. I was right. It was analytics. And we look at the companies that are doing really well right now, so Health Catalyst, Cerner's doing investments in analytics, so analytics is the big thing in health IT. Mark my words, camera, the next white space is care management, care coordination. Right? This is, what?
I thought that was the last one.
It's the next one, it's going to disrupt the electronic health record.
Yeah, it's already happened.
Right? So the EHR is going to die. the monolithic EHR is going to die. We're going to see care management.
Government regulations just put into place this year for EHR.
Which ones? What are you talking about?
No, EHR for all healthcare. They had either approved EHR or they had to pay a penalty this year.
So in New York, I don't know which ones you're talking about.
No, I'm talking about throughout the U.S.
So, again, I don't know what you're talking about. So EHR regs?
Yeah, so if I own an outpatient hospital,
right,
you know, an outpatient surgery center, I have to have all my records on EHR and be able to do everything electronically, or I have to pay a penalty.
Meaningful use.
So those are the regs that the organizations that I was involved
with. Right. So I'm just saying they just got to that, and you're saying now they're going to be out.
Those regs were implemented first in 2011.
Yeah.
Their teeth are setting in.
Right. 2017.
The last couple of years, 2017, 2018, they're enhanced requirements that are expected. In New York State, there are actually new requirements around EHR certification in long-term care treatment facilities. So this is a brand new thing just for New York. If you're involved in a long-term care treatment facility and your product isn't a certified EHR, you don't get money that allows you to connect with health information exchanges. So lots of stuff. Yes, I am saying the EHR itself. Now notice, we're talking about EHR. In the last iteration of regulations that came out from the organization I used to work with, we changed the nomenclature. We actually said certified health information technology. And that's important because if you think of EHR as the monolithic EHR, sure, that's the incumbent product. The reason that we changed the language to certified health information technology was to open things up to new products, right? Because government's role is to create a framework that allows innovators to do what innovators should do. Rather than constrain startups or innovators to do exactly what they think they should be doing. So in the first couple of iterations of those regulations, it said EHR. And then there's all these requirements of what an EHR is. Now, today, for 2017 and 2018, it says certified health information technology, which means it could be a care management solution. It could be something that somebody in a garage in Kansas comes up with, so long as it's certified. Now, certified just means it's tested and it can do the stuff that you says it can say it can do, and there are certain criteria for that. So we tried.
Recessivity requirements.
What's that?
Recessivity requirements for certification.
So the certification requirements are specifically defined. They're defined by ONC, and it's things like the problemist uses SNOMED CT, a standard for transmission of medical problems. The allergy list uses, a certain nomenclature. So the specifications are defined by ONC, and it's very clear. These are standards, of course, because the government doesn't create standards. Standards that have been created by the industry. So not off topic a little bit there. But innovation has been, and creating a framework that encourages innovation has always been what I've been focused on and trying to help facilitate innovation. So in December, I was asked to take on the leadership of an organization called the Alliance for Better Health. Then it was called the Alliance for Better Health Care. But as Sean and I discussed online, I think yesterday, is it health that we care about or health care that we care about? Right? Because if we're doing our jobs really well, it's health. And we become unnecessary, those involved in care. Right? So ideally, I would argue, the Department of Health and Human Services is what it's called. The New York State Department of Health is what it's called. Locally, we've got St. Peter's Health Partners. So I think that the focus, and this is to our perhaps future discussion about the name of this group, I think the focus has to be on health rather than healthcare. Because if we're really being successful, we're focused on health. Healthcare may become a part of that, but ideally we put ourselves out of business because the population is completely healthy and nobody ever needs to go to a hospital. Right? As I've been thinking about how it is that I contribute to my local community. I decided to join this organization, the Alliance for Better Healthcare, now renamed as of 3 days ago, the Alliance for Better Health. Raise your hand if you've heard of DISRIP. You know what that is?
DISRIP.
It's okay. So I asked the question. So for the 42% of you who haven't heard of it, DISRIP stands for Delivery System Reform Innovation Payment Program. It is a federally funded New York State program. So CMS, the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, gave New York the flexibility to invest $8 billion in this program. So the $8 billion would have gone to fee-for-service Medicaid, which is a patient goes to the hospital, hospital submits a bill, New York State Department of Health pays the bill, everybody's happy. What New York said to CMS, because CMS ultimately sends 90% of the money to New York to support the Medicaid program. New York said, hey, can we take some of that money that we're going to spend over the next 5 years for fee-for-service Medicaid and just put it off to the side and see if we can reduce unnecessary use of care delivery services? And the Fed said, sure, we're in for that. So what's unnecessary use? Somebody go to the emergency department for something that doesn't need to be done in the emergency department. Because the way we've structured healthcare so far, as I said healthcare, is that we've given positive reinforcement for exactly the wrong behaviors, right? So we pay the hospital more if they see more patients. So this is stupid, right? More care, more money. Which then means that as a physician, as a hospital, I have no incentive to keep my patients healthy because the sicker they are, the more they come to me. The more they come to me, the more money I make. This is dumb, right? So New York said, let's change this and let's put money into these organizations called performing provider systems. So performing provider systems were created in 2014. And they said, well, let's take a big pile of cash and create an infrastructure in the community so that we can anticipate the health needs of the community and prevent folks from needing to go to the hospital. So if I can take a kid with asthma and I can look at data about that kid with asthma, let's say a kid with asthma isn't using their inhalers properly. Okay, and I can actually see that from claims data. Is there anybody knows anybody with asthma? Two kinds of medicines we prescribe. One is usually called a preventer, usually an inhaled corticosteroid. The other is a reliever. If you've ever been to a soccer game with anybody with asthma, you've watched the kid run off to the field and say, Mom, can I have my inhaler? That's a reliever. It helps them breathe a little bit better. But that kid probably wasn't using their preventer, because if they were, they'd never have an asthma exacerbation. They'd never go to the emergency department. Everything would be great. And so I can look at claims data and see, well, look, this little Johnny from Troy, New York, filled 19 prescriptions for his reliever and zero for his preventer. So then I can go, maybe I should call little Johnny's doctor and get that doctor to prescribe a preventer, and maybe we'll get a community health worker to go out and teach mom and little Johnny and maybe even dad how to manage that kid's asthma. So the kind of proactive work that we know needs to happen, but we've never paid for it. We've never thought about that in a critical way. And so that's what the Alliance for Better Health is doing, is looking at a set of activities. So I was inspired by the mission of the organization. So now I'm leading the organization. I've been doing it since December. We have, looking at the video camera now, a shit ton of money that we can deploy to do this sort of work. And so Terry Spina we hired today. And so one of my enthusiastic reasons for being here tonight was to meet with all of you folks and maybe sort of carry this activity forward. We'd love to have a large event in the summer, revised from the spring. Maybe it'll still be spring if it's early June.
My daughter's going to hear it any of the time tomorrow.
Right. Okay, so we can't do it in June because Terry's daughter's getting married. We are thinking of calling the Capital Region Health Innovation Summit. mirrored after events that I've witnessed both from the kids at Junto Health, and I'm sure Sean's familiar with Doug and his group in New York City, where you create roundtable activities, but at the same time you have startups who come and pitch. What I've noticed, and I'm not pointing the finger at anybody, is that the Capital District does not yet have the rich culture of innovation, especially in health and health delivery, that I've experienced in other places, New York City, Washington, Baltimore even, and obviously Silicon Valley. So I've been in those communities, I've worked with lots of people in those communities. Most of the startups that I work with personally are either based in New York City or they're based in the California Bay Area. One or two, in fact, two that I work with are in DC or Baltimore. So, but nobody here, actually I am an advisor of one company here that pitched the other night at the Population Health Conference. But
what company?
That's Sommel Health. So I'm an advisor to Sommel Health. But I would say the three pitches that I saw the other night, and I'll say this for the video, sucked. They were shitty pitches. So how can we help people learn how to pitch better, how to come up with a good pitch deck, how to understand the needs of their market before they go try to either, you know, pitch. So what's the purpose of a pitch? To build a customer base, right? Or to attract investment. But I was impressed that none of the three companies that I saw pitching the other night really hit the nail on the head. So I'd love to help organizations hit the nail on the head. Our idea for this summit that would happen in the summer is that we'd get startup companies to pitch with a specific eye toward meeting some of the objectives of the DSRIP program. So the DSRIP program has sponsored three entities in the capital region. One is ours, essentially owned by Albany Med, and the other's owned by Adirondack Health Institute in Glens Falls. And there's a fourth sort of semi-distant at Bassett in Cooperstown. So four organizations combined, there's $500 million to be deployed. $500 million.
Can I ask you for clarification? Insurance companies are motivated to keep us healthy, the private insurers, but when you're talking about Medicaid people, which is are we saying that that's the primary population?
Insurance companies are motivated to keep us healthy in some ways. An interesting factoid that I was taught by a friend of mine, and you can help me, you know, you can correct me, because some of my best friends work for health plans, but that's something I've never done. I work for HHS, which of course is the biggest health plan in the country, but I've never worked for Anthem or Blue Cross or MVP or CDPHP. But I was talking with a friend of mine at United Health Group, actually, and asked the same question. So why is it that United Health Group hasn't pushed the envelope on value-based care more aggressively? And I guess we could ask, why do you think Anthem hasn't pushed the envelope on value-based care more aggressively? Yesterday, I was talking with a guy from CDPHP, like, why haven't you pushed the envelope? Well, the answer from my UHG friend was, well, you know, we charge businesses a certain amount of money to, you know, pass through the money that passes through us. We try and administer it properly, but really we're just a pass-through. Like, if our costs are X percent, and let's say our costs are $800 billion, and we take, say, 6% of that $800 billion, then we get 6% of $800 billion. And if we get 6% of $700 billion because we've cut costs appropriately downstream, we have 6% of $700 billion instead.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if I agree with that.
Okay.
So I just think it's true. It's easy to be cynical and think that's the answer, but I think that it's just not there yet. I mean, it's hard to evaluate. I think the metrics aren't established yet. I think that, you know, I know that Anthem has a whole group dedicated on value-based financing. It's all about delivering. I mean, I think the profit motive for the big companies, at least in the commercial side of business, I'm not in the government side of business, is to deliver value to the company. So the company is actually the customer. And, you know, the patients, we call them members, which is, that's my crawl, but, they are secondary. So, you know, I think ultimately it's, hey, if we can deliver value to the company, we can charge the company more for the work we're doing to lower their costs. But I think the issue is no one's figured out how to figure out value. I mean, what's valuable? How do you figure out that you've saved money?
Right.
You know, we're talking about bundled care, for instance. I mean, you know, I manage a newborn intensive care. You know, we're talking about babies that cost the company $500,000 to $1 million per baby per year. And there's lots of babies that are coming out. You know, you talk about polluting the gene pool. We're saving everything. And these babies are just suck up money. I mean, they're just expensive.
And yet,
but a well mother program could have prevented $1 million.
Perhaps.
So I mean, that's what the whole ACO model is all about, right?
I think that would affect some of them.
Well, this, I think it's a great, and you know, I said what I said to be provocative and provoke you with response. But that's the kind of thing, right? So Alex nailed it. One of the companies that I invested in is a company called BabyScripts. What does BabyScripts do? I don't know if you're familiar with that.
I am.
But you know, they are trying to be proactive. What they're doing is they're reducing the frequency with which moms have to go to the doctor, but they're increasing the fidelity of data that is going to the doctor, right? It's a remote monitoring system, mom takes her blood pressure every day, she weighs herself every day, but they reduce the number of office visits.
Right.
So mom's happy, she doesn't have to drive across town to go to the doctor. Doctor's happy because if he's got a case of preeclampsia coming, he knows it or she knows it, you know, days to weeks before they would have otherwise, and they can intervene. And so we get better outcomes, and then you know, your kid skips the ICU, or ideally skips the ICU. So these are the kinds of things that I would love to see. Common guiding principles: more health, less care. So I'll shut up at that point. Hope that met some of your wishes and expectations.
Thank you.
Against a mini hoonie, well, you fall smaller. Middle school rapper and a proud, yes, y'all up.